For many years, John 3:16 was the most well-known scripture in the Bible. I read an article a few years ago that said Matthew 7 had surpassed it as being the most alluded to or the most spoken verse in the Bible. This verse simply reads like this: "Judge not that you be not judged, for with the same judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged, and with what measure ye meet, it shall be measured to you again." In Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, he announced many of the precepts of the coming kingdom and described a great many things that would come to characterize the members of the Lord's kingdom. He described the nature of his disciples, their treatment of friends and enemies alike, and as well as their preparation for eternity. In this, he also includes the idea of judgment when he said, "Judge not that you be not judged." In our society of guilt-free living, this verse is often quoted or alluded to. When a spurious religious doctrine is questioned, somebody says, "Judge not." When a position is called into debate, "Judge not" is the retort. And when a sinful or degrading lifestyle is noted, someone says, "Who am I to judge?" often in an effort to quiet those who would speak against it. Our society today desires to live without being questioned, examined, and especially not rebuked. And if you're bold enough to disagree with an idea, if you're bold enough to disagree with something that's going on, then likely or not, you're going to be told that you don't have the right to judge. And in order to enforce that, they say, "Judge not that you be not judged." Well, very briefly this afternoon, I want to talk to you about what Jesus teaches here. Many in our society might be surprised to find out that Jesus is not saying, "Don't judge." Jesus is not saying don't formulate judgment, but he is teaching a grander, more nobler principle. And I'm afraid all too often we forget that and we overlook that in our haste to simply silence critics. From the unmistakable words of Christ, we see that some form or some idea of judgment is being condemned. But the question is what? What is he talking about? I think there are some things from studying the Bible in other places that as well become apparent. First of all, we can see that Jesus here is not condemning, if you will, governmental judgment. Judgment is a part of the work of government and therefore is not forbidden. Over here in the book of Romans chapter 13 and verse 1, the scripture says, "Let every soul be subject unto the higher powers, for there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Whosoever therefore resisteth the power resisteth the ordinance of God, and they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to the evil. Wilt thou then not be afraid of the power? Do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. For he is the minister of God to thee for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid. For he beareth not the sword in vain. For he is the minister of God, a revenger, to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil." Quite obviously, in order for civil law or civil government, if you will, to govern a people, there must be judgment. There are going to be situations in which the people must be examined to decide whether they are right or wrong, whether they've complied with the law or have not. That is authorized by God. And obviously then is not what Jesus is talking about. Two, the Bible teaches us as well that there are private judgments, if you will, that must be made. Notice this. In Acts chapter 4 and verse 19, the scripture says, "But Peter and John answered and said unto them, whether it be right in the sight of God to hearken unto you more than unto God, judge ye." These men had been confronted with the situation. These men here had been preaching the word of God and teaching the word of God, but the Jews wanted them to stop. The council had stopped them and brought them before them and forbid them to preach the word of God. And then here's what Peter answers. "You decide. You judge. Should we listen to you rather than listening to God?" Again, in the book of Romans chapter 14 and verse 22, the scripture says, "Hast thou faith? Have it to thyself before God. Happy is he that condemneth not himself in that thing which he alloweth." Quite obviously, then, the Bible teaches us that there are some judgments that have to be made. There are some judgments that God has authorized. And so, the Lord Jesus Christ is not condemning judgment in general. He is not saying you can never make a decision, you can never make a judgment, you can never look at someone else or some situation and decide what's good or bad or right or wrong in that situation. However, he is being very specific. Notice this in verse 3. The scripture says, "And why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye, but considerest not the beam that is in thine own eye? Or how wilt thou say to thy brother, let me pull out the mote out of thine eye, and behold, a beam is in thine own eye? Thou hypocrite, first cast out the beam out of thine own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to cast out the mote out of thy brother's eye." Now Jesus uses here a rather exaggerated illustration to talk about the judgment that he's speaking of. He says here you have a situation of a man who's got a mote in his eye, which is a very small thing, a speck, perhaps a grain of sawdust or maybe a grain of sand. And while the man has that thing in his eye, perhaps he's trying to get it out or find out what the problem is, there's another man, here's where the exaggeration comes in, that has a beam in his eye. Now this refers to a large object. Whereas one man will have a grain of sawdust in his eye, this other man's got a 2x4 sticking out of his head. And so here's what Jesus says. That man with the beam then becomes hypocritical to judge or to consider to the man, to condemn rather the man who has the sawdust or the mote in his eye. So what's Jesus talking about? Well, he illustrates here the fact that the person with the larger problem cannot condemn the person with the less. Notice, if you will, it would be like the habitual liar condemning a person for a single untruth, or the gossip who condemns a person for repeating an occasional tale. The man with the beam not only is in sin, but has more and greater problems than he with the mote. What's Christ talking about? He's talking about hypocritical judgment. When a man who is involved in sin, when a man who is involved in error, openly condemns a man who has an occasional sin in his life. Maybe he's faltered or failed or yielded to an occasional temptation. Jesus here is talking about the man who lives in sin, condemning the man who stumbles into sin. And so here's what I understand. Christ today is not condemning judgment or making decisions concerning right or wrong in general, but he is talking about hypocritical judgment. For a man in sin to condemn another for the very thing he does, he himself has sin to bear. In Romans chapter 2 and verse 1, the scripture says, "Therefore thou art inexcusable, O man, whosoever thou art that judgest, for wherein thou judgest another, thou condemnest thyself, for thou that judges doeth the same things. But we are sure that the judgment of God is according to truth against them which commit such things. And thinkest thou this, O man, that judgest them which do such things, and doest the same, that thou shalt escape the judgment of God?" And so Paul summarizes the very idea that Jesus here speaks of. When we condemn others for the very sins we commit, then we commit hypocritical judgment. And that's exactly what Jesus is talking about. But I want you to get this. I think the heart of this verse is not, or the heart of this teaching is not in verse 1 or 2 or verse 3 or even verse 4. I think the heart of this teaching is found in verse 5, where Jesus says, "Thou hypocrite, first cast the beam out of thine own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to cast out the mote out of thy brother's eye." Now listen, folks, this is the heart of this teaching. As I say, in our effort to live a guilt-free life, to do whatever we want to and get away with it, people use this verse to silence critics. And somehow we've gotten to the point that we believe that that is the thrust of what Jesus is talking about. That if you disagree with someone, you don't have the right to say anything. If you think somebody's wrong, then you are condemned if you speak out against it. And that's not the heart of it. Here's the heart of it. First, clean up your own life. First, cast the beam out of thine eye. First, make sure that you're able, that you're ready, that your example, that your life qualifies you to help someone else. In Romans 2 and verse 21, the scripture says, "Thou therefore which teachest another, teachest thou not thyself? Thou that preachest a man should not steal, dost thou steal? Thou that sayest the man should not commit adultery, dost thou commit adultery? Thou that abhorrest idols, dost thou commit sacrilege? Thou that makest thy boast of the law through breaking the law, dishonorest thou God? For the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles through you, as it is written. Now that had been a historical problem with the Jews. Their looking at the law, reading the law, but not following the law had caused them to be condemned by the Gentiles, who looked at them and pointed out the fact that they won't even follow their own law. Why should I become a proselyte? Why should I accept their religion? Why should I accept their condemnation? They don't even follow their own law, which they claim is from God. So here's what Paul says. If you're going to preach, if you're going to teach, if you're going to condemn others, make sure yourself, that you are living the truth. Our example either commends us or it condemns us. In Galatians 6 and verse 1, the Apostle Paul echoes exactly what Jesus is talking about when he says, "Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself also, lest thou also be tempted or be condemned, as it were." Notice he says, the point is, the man who is going to help others, the man who is going to make judgments of others, first of all, needs to clean his old life up. Now folks, that's the point of this teaching. That's the point of what Jesus is saying. Listen, to see a man going on in sin, to see a man going on in error and say nothing, does not help that man. To see a man going on in sin and say nothing about his sinful life only allows him to go further down the road to hell. And this idea today that you can't disagree, that you can't judge someone, that you can't look at someone's life and say that's wrong, and therefore you've got to keep your mouth shut, is absolutely unscriptural. The fact of the matter is, Jesus is teaching that very thing. Jesus is teaching judgment. Jesus is teaching that you look at others. Jesus is teaching that you help others commend, or rather, change their life and repent of their sins. But the first thing you do is examine your life. Make sure you're living out the book. Make sure you're living out the truth. Make sure you're standing up for what's right, and then your example will qualify you to be able to help others. Over here in John chapter 2 and verse 48, the scripture says, "He that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judgeth him. The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day." Again, in Revelation 20 and verse 12, the scripture says, "And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which are written in the books, according to their works." And so here's what we understand. We are today to all walk by the same rule. We today are to all walk by God's divine word. When we see others, whether they be brethren or not, in error, we are then to be able to help them to repent of their sins, to be able to help them to correct their lives, to be able to point out the error in their life and help them to make themselves right with God. But the thing that qualifies you to do that is living the truth of God's word yourself. And that's exactly what Jesus here is teaching. Someone says, "Well, are we to judge?" Many today simply believe that we're supposed to live in a way where we keep our beliefs and our ideas to ourselves, and we don't judge anything or anyone else. Well, the scripture teaches contrary to that. As a matter of fact, the scripture teaches that judgment is required. In Acts 4 and verse 19, the scripture says, "But Peter and John answered and said unto them, Whether it be right in the sight of God to hearken unto you more than unto God, judge ye." What is required in every aspect of our life is to judge what is right according to God's divine word. That's what he's saying here. Whether it's right in the sight of God, that's the judgment you've got to make. And so the Bible teaches us that there are some things we must judge. Number one, we must learn to judge ourselves. In Acts 13 and verse 46, the scripture says, "Then Paul and Barnabas waxed bold and said, it was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken unto you, but seeing you put it from you and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, lo, we turn to the Gentiles." Their judgment of themselves was that they did not need salvation, that they should not have salvation. Now the apostle here really is reasoning backwards. It was not as though these people said, "Look, Paul, we're glad you came through, but we don't want what you're peddling." No, that was not it at all. Paul had preached the gospel to them, and they had rejected that truth. And Paul says, "We've drawn a conclusion. This is the conclusion we've come to. You've judged yourselves. You've considered yourselves, and you've decided that you don't want salvation. Well, we're going somewhere else. We're not going to stay here. We're not going to spin our wheels anymore. We're going to preach to someone who wants the truth." Again, in 1 Corinthians 11 and verse 31, the Bible says, "For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. And when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world." Now, Paul makes it even clearer. If we'll learn to look at ourselves and judge ourselves, if we'll learn to be introspective and look at what we're teaching, what we're saying, how we're living, how we view the scriptures, then we won't be rebuked as often. We won't be condemned as often. And when we are chastened of the Lord. Now here's another idea that's very interesting to me. You know, there's been a great shift in the psychology of men through the years, especially in respect to religion and worship. There was a time when worship was about God and serving the Lord. But you know, the mantra of our day is attend the church of your choice. Find a church that you like. Find a church that's appealing to you. Find a church that has the programs that you like. Find a church that's up to your standards. And if you're entertained by it, then that's where you need to be. But you know, the fact of the matter is, worship is not about me. Worship is about God and ascribing to Him praise and honor and glory. Well, you know what's gone hand in hand with that? When someone takes the Word of God, the Scriptures, and points out error in our life, all too often we take it personal. And instead of looking at those verses and what they say and say, "You know, that's what the Bible says. Yeah, I can see that. That is what the Bible says. I need to do that." You know what we do? We put them off. We say things like, "Well, I'll study on it. I'll look into that. Not me and you. I'll look into that." We get upset. You know, we get our tail in the air about it like an old tomcat. We just decide, "Listen, I ain't putting up with this, and I'm not going to talk to you about it. I don't like what you've got to say about it, and so you just need to go on and leave me alone." You know why we do that? It's because our focus in religion is on us rather than the Lord. You know what the Bible says in the book of Proverbs? "Only by pride cometh contention." Only by pride. Let me tell you something, brethren. Anytime two brethren butt heads, anytime there's a conflict in a congregation, anytime you have problems in the church, the root of the problem may not be false doctrine. The root of the problem may not be an overbearing individual. The root of the problem is always, without exception, pride. You know how I know that? Because the Bible says, "Only by pride cometh contention." You know what's happened to us? We've learned to make the world, make us the center of our universe. The apostle says, on the other hand, we need to learn to judge ourselves first before we're judged by the preaching of God's word. But secondly, the Bible teaches us to judge others. Yes, that we're to judge the life and the actions of others. In 1 Corinthians 5 and verse 13, the apostle says, "For I verily, as absent in the body, but present in spirit, have judged already, as though I were present concerning him that has done this deed." Now get that. The apostle Paul was not down there in Corinth, but he had heard from the house of Chloe and from others the situation that was going on down there. These people had reported to Paul that there was a man down there who had taken up with his father's wife. And you know what Paul said? "Well, that's none of my business. Y'all take care of that. Y'all work it out, and I hope to see you soon." No, it's not what Paul said at all. Paul said, "I'm not there, but I've already judged. I've already looked at the decision, or rather looked at the action, and made a decision." In Romans 2 and verse 27, the scripture says, "And shall not uncircumcision, which is by nature, if it fulfill the law, judge thee, who by the letter and circumcision dost transgress the law?" Yes, here was a situation where these Gentiles were going to judge or condemn the Hebrews. Why? Because by nature, they did the things that were contained in the law. And their life, their deeds, and their actions were actually better than the Hebrews who had the law and wouldn't keep it. The apostle says they were judged by them. Again, in 1 Corinthians 5 and verse 12, "For what have I to do to judge them also that are without? Doth not ye judge them that are within? But them that are without God judges. Therefore put away from yourselves that wicked person." You know what Paul says? It's time for y'all to make a judgment. Now this verse goes hand in hand with verse 3 where he said, "I've already made a judgment. I've made a judgment. And now it's time for you to make a judgment. You look at this situation and what this man has done and you put him away from you." And so here's what I conclude. It's absolutely scriptural and right to judge whether the actions of another brother or sister in Christ are scriptural or not. And if they're not unscriptural, then is the opportunity for you to fulfill the words of Jesus Christ by helping them pluck the mote out of their eye, rather than standing idly by and watching them wander down the road to hell. Thirdly, the Bible teaches us that we are to judge the words that are spoken. In 1 Corinthians 10 and verse 15, the scripture says, "I speak as to wise men, judge ye what I say." Again, in Job 34 and verse 3, he says, "For the ear trieth words as the mouth tasteth meat." And so I understand today that I am to judge what I'm taught. I'm to judge what is spoken to me. Those words that are taught to me in the pulpit or in private conversation, when we discuss the word of truth with someone, whether they be Christian or not, those things that are spoken to us, we judge. We listen to those things. We observe those things and we make a decision. Either this is right or this is wrong. Now the Bible teaches us we don't do it by some private rule. John 5 and 30 says, "I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just, because I seek not mine own will, but the will of the Father which hath sent me." Now that's how your judgment will be just, when it's compared to the will of God's word. Whenever you begin to take what is told to you, whatever you begin to take what is lived out in your life and the life of others, and hold it up to God's word. If it fits, keep it. If it doesn't, condemn it. And help those who are involved in it to get out of it. Romans 2 and verse 2, he says, "But we are sure that the judgment of God is according to truth against them which commit such things." And so I understand today that there are some things that I must judge. I must judge myself. I must judge the life of my brethren. I must judge the law, the things that are spoken and taught to me, in order not only that I can live right, but so I can help others live right. But you know, there are some things that you cannot judge. You know, there are times when you cannot make a judgment. There are some things today that are simply and only matters of conscience. You know, there are some things the Bible is not so clear about as there are others. And in those matters, we are required to make a judgment. Romans chapter 4, verses 3 through 13, the apostle talks about that, as well as 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 29, when he says, "Conscience I say, not thine own, but of the other, for why is my liberty judge of another man's conscience?" The fact of the matter is, there are some things that the Bible does not delineate as right or wrong, good or bad, and you've got to make a judgment about those things as to whether you're going to be involved in them. Well, you know, you may decide, "Yes, I'm going to do that." Or another brother may decide, "Yes, I'm going to do that." And you might be on the other side of the fence. You may look at that thing and say, "You know, no, I don't feel good about that. The Bible doesn't say yes or no, but I just don't feel good about that, and I'm not going to do that." You know, in that situation, I can't condemn the man who's involved in it. The man who says yes, even though I say no, that's his conscience. And he's got to make that decision. And so the Bible teaches us very clearly that when it comes to matters of things that God has not legislated upon, in those matters of conscience, we must decide whether we can do that in good conscience before God, and whether we can do that in service to God. You know, one of the things I think is a good question whenever you talk about liberties is, can I do this to the glory of God? Is this going to be a good example? Is this going to make my light shine brighter? Now, I've heard everything in the world lumped into liberties. Anything you can talk about, from aspects of modesty to celebrating holidays, somebody throws that in the liberty pile and says, well, you know, that's all a liberty. Well, you've got to be very careful with that. Let me caution you, brethren, to be very careful with that. The Bible teaches us when it comes to those things, of course, judgments cannot be made. But on the other hand, it does say that when it comes to matters of liberty, since it's a liberty, we're at liberty to not do it. You know, in the 21st century, our view of liberty is, it's a liberty, so you can't stop me. But in the first century, when Paul wrote those words in Romans 14, as well as 1 Corinthians 8 and 1 Corinthians 10, every time he addresses it, he makes the point, it's a liberty, so you can do without. It's a liberty, so don't do it. It's a liberty, so don't destroy another man's conscience. It's a liberty, so give it up. Yes, those are things on which we cannot judge. But on the other hand, those are also things with which we can do without. And so here's what I understand today. The thrust of Jesus' teaching becomes very clear when we look at it in its context and in its setting. The thrust of Jesus' teaching was simply this. You live in a way. You act in a way. You teach in a way. You conduct yourself in a way that's above reproach, so that you can help those who are in sin. And really, isn't that what this meeting's all about? Isn't that why we're here? Isn't that why we're going to go knock doors this afternoon? Isn't that why we're going to meet in the park for the rest of the week? Well, it goes hand in hand to that. It's first of all the Christian life that you're living. The service you give to God. Is it above reproach? Well, it needs to be. So we can tell those in sin how they can correct their lives, and the focus be on error rather than on us. How are things with you this afternoon? You're not a Christian? Why not become one today? Why not tonight step up believing Jesus Christ is the Son of God? Why not tonight repent of your sins and confess your faith in Christ as the only begotten of the Father? And today, why not be baptized for the remission of your sins? We beg you come while we stand and sing.